the dock with tow and towing services. The objective of the lecture today is to discuss a little bit of dark web and the technology, the most popular technology behind the dark web, that is Tor. And we will discuss in detail how Tor works and how the Tor hidden service works. The web. So basically we divide web into three groups, which we call it as surface web or the clear web and the deep web and the dark web. So we can think like a web in total as iceberg. So what we can see in the iceberg is very small part of the web. In the iceberg, you know, and usually we see a very small part. Similar to that, we usually see very small part of the web that is indexed by the typical search engines or the traditional search engines. So the surface is the web pages were indexed by the traditional search engines. So we see and we visit and we work usually with the surface web. The other way we mostly get involved is the deep web. Deep web contents are not indexed, not searchable because of that. These are the content where someone should access after providing some author indication. That means, so your Gmail account content, your Facebook account contents, which is not given as public, Facebook private content, and whatever the content where you don't give the public access, considered into the deep web. In the deep web, content is not searchable. Because in the search engine robots or the search engine spiders may not see this content. In order to access this content, always you need to provide some authentication. So deep web are the places where we have the personal access. Then the third part, we call it as dark web. It is the content accessible only using specific software and hardware. So these contents, usually we don't know about it. And some of these contents basically access only using specific softwares. So those specific softwares varies based on the technology we use. One of the popular open technology called Tor is discussed in this lecture. The dark web content, so there is a concept called it as dark net as well. Some people get confused, the dark net, dark web. It's similar to internet and the web. In the internet is interconnected networks. So on top of the internet, you know, there are so many application works like email, web, file sharing services, and so on. Similar to that, so in the dark net is the network where publicly not accessible. So there are several applications run on top of that. Dark web is only one. So the focus of this lecture today is the net, not the net, the web, the World Wide Web. So as I mentioned, the web has three components, surface web, deep web, and the dark web. We only see the on top of the iceberg, that is surface web. The huge part of this web is hidden to us as deep web and the dark web. So researchers basically assumed or kind of like basically calculated, 90% of the web contents are under deep and dark component. So only 10% we can see as the surface web. So with that, you can understand that there's a huge set of content where we may not be able to access and see using regular methods. So if you are open source intelligent expert or authentic expert, or if you are a forensic expert, forensic analysis, you should be aware of how to access this content, as well as you should be aware of to kind of use those technologies where you get hit with using those, where you get access to huge content where you cannot access through the surface web technologies like standard browsers. Right. So this concept of dark web or the started. So we in this lecture, actually, we discuss concentrate on the dark web, not the deep web. So the concept of this dark web started with the concept of anonymity. So as you may understood, or as you may know, the first internet application, kind of first internet application is the email, not the web. Email started somewhere in the 80s. The web started somewhere in the 90s. So when the email started, people think about how do you write messages without revealing our identity. So that is what we call anonymity. So in the other side, we discuss in the security world, information security domain, we discuss about the concept, call it as authenticity, that we discuss how to identify the people or which connect over the internet. Anonymity is exactly opposite of that. Anonymity discusses about how do we connect without revealing your identity. So these two concepts contradict each other. So in some set of application, we require authenticity. Other set of applications, we need anonymity. So this lecture, based on the anonymity that in the dark web, everybody is anonymous. We are not revealing our identity with any means. No one will be able to get trace about us and our activities. So the concept of anonymity started with the mailers, as I said. So there is a recipients and the senders. So there was a mailers call it as mail relays. So at the first generation of this anonymity technology used such relays. So in those relays, we can define set of relays, one or two. Originally, it was one. And we send the mail to that, and it then forward to someone else. So then the recipient may not understand the sender or not get the detail about the sender. So then when the web started, that concept has kind of extended for the web as well. And it created the idea of web proxies. So the kind of first organization which created such anonymous web proxy, call it as Anonymous. So this service, I think, is still running. So it's an open source proxy where anyone can use. So I like this definition. It says many mice surf the web under the illusion that their actions are private and anonymous. Actually, you should know it is not. If you are a forensic person, you know how to trace those actions. So mice, that is people, usual people think it is not possible, that is an illusion, it is possible. And unfortunately, this is the way it is. Why time you visit the site for the piece of cheese, you leave the calling card that reveal where you are coming from, what kind of computer you use and other details. And many cats keep log for your visits. Cats are government agents, law enforcement authorities, and the bad guys, hackers. Mice are us. So it says, so that we can catch you, this service allows you to surf the web without revealing any personal information, anonymous. You can try it. I think it still works. So it's the first kind of service in the world where provide the people to access the web content without revealing their identity. So identity means the web IP, IP address, internet IP address, and many other things like your browser detail and your operating system details and so on. If you want to access some content, you can use such web proxies. So some countries, you know, even in Sri Lanka, some news website was abandoned. So even you can go to those websites using such web proxies. So the issue with these web proxies like Anonymous is basically this single website or the single organization will see what we want. So if a law enforcement authority or the hacker or bad guy or anyone who got access to those single proxy, so they will see our entire communication or our entire trace. So it is dangerous. It not provide what we call it as the concept of, maybe we can say it like, it not provide the forward secrecy. That means someone in the future hacked into those may get what we did. So we would like to have a technology where no one will be able to trace us. Not only today, maybe in the future. So for such, what we should do? So basically, as I mentioned, so the Anonymous or other mixnet technology use a single relay. So instead of Alice directly talk to Bob, so Alice go to relay, a proxy server or a mail relay, and that relay contact Bob. Then Bob only get the information about the relay, not the Alice. But relay get the information about the Alice. So the single mix or the single proxy fails because even there are cases where some people manage to get control of those single proxy or the mixnet routers, and with that they trace back to you, because if someone get access to this, so he see entire communication with all people through this network and what they did. So we need to improve this weakness on the point of anonymity. How do you do that? Somewhere around 1988, the person called Chung extend this mixnet content to multiple mixers. So as I mentioned, this is, at that time there were no web, it was for email. So they have extended concept of mixnet to running a multiple mixers. Each mixer keeps public keys. And when the Alice were to talk to Bob, Alice established what they call it as circuit. And those circuits, Alice gets symmetric keys, session keys of each mixers. So then Alice message will be encrypted to the Bob. Alice message is encrypted actually to the mixer 3 first. And then the mixer 2. And then finally to mixer 1. So then it sends to mixer 1. Mixer 1 will decrypt its part, forward to the mixer 2. Mixer 2 will decrypt his part and forward to the mixer 3. Mixer 3 will see the destination and message will be forward to the destination. So then the destination person responds to back to the master three. Master three knows it should encrypt and forward to the master two. Master two encrypt and forward to the master one. Master one forward it to the encrypt and forward to Alice. Since Alice knows the three keys, she can decrypt and get the content. So this idea MixNet introduced 1981, usually 40 years ago, on the purpose of email. So later when we have the web, people kind of standardize it and create some open protocol called Onion Routing Protocol. So Onion Routing Protocol works exactly the same way. So the concept is having multiple mixers. So I discuss the issue with a single mixer. So by introducing multiple mixers, what we do is adding some complexity of tracing. So for example, if someone get control to the X, he may not get the entire trace of some people. So if some law enforcement authority or the bad guy wants to see what we do, so he or she has to get control of all three mixers, if there are three. So getting control of more than one mixer at the same time, it's not so easy. So that makes a difficulty of some people to trace on. So Onion Routing introduced a generic concept, how you can add multiple mixers when you are communicating. It may be 2, 3, or maybe 10, 20. You can go through so many mixers. So as you may understood, adding additional mixers may add more latency into the communication because you have to send it through several parties. So by doing that, so you create a system where practically no one will be able to trace our activities. So the idea which call it as Onion Routing, so some group of people extended this idea and create an open source project called Tor Project. They have designed a nice open protocol to talks anonymously over the web. As usual, all those technologies usually start with the purpose of military. Similarly, this Tor protocol and the project initially funded by US Navy and some other funding agencies in United States. Later on, somewhere around 2012, maybe as I remember, 10-12 period. So that went to the public. And now it has an entirely independent new board with internet, consists of journalists, lawyers, and internet activists, and also with the well-known cryptographer Shannon. So like the top group of people which really concerned on privacy now govern this project. And the project is called as Tor Projects. The Tor Projects creates circuits leading to destination. And this circuit creation, entire control of most of the control of the circuit creation at the user side. So each relay or each relay at the middle, mixers at the middle, will unwrap their layers and forward these packets to the destinations or their destination. It's one drop, one hop wrapping. It uses one hop wrapping and can add any number of hops. The encryption the payload, they use symmetric key. Symmetric key will be an exchange using Diffie-Hellman key exchange. So on top of that, each nodes talk to each other using TLS. So it's heavy security. That means heavy load to the bandwidth as well. But the concepts right now is well accepted, even though they have some weaknesses. I say it's theoretical weaknesses. So we will discuss towards the end of this lecture, what are they? As I mentioned, this protocol and the software originally sponsored by US Naval Research Laboratory. And in 2004 to 2006, it is supported by EFT, electronic, I don't remember that. I think it's Electronic Frontier Foundation or something like that in US. And after 2006, it runs with the public funded open source project. And somewhere around, as I mentioned, somewhere around 2010 to 2012, the entirely new board appointed to this, disconnecting all the connection to the US Naval Research for the US original of this source. So this source created in, as a result of Naval Research is the base still. However, it is open source and verified by so many people in the world, which really, really concerned on the anonymity. So because of that, we can trust the code as we can use the tool now for whatever our activities. So the people who govern this project, kind of trusted people in the world where they are really concerned on the anonymity of the people, or they are really concerned on the privacy of individuals. They don't want to see people are looking for. So we want to know these things in detail. Now, let's see how this works. If you want to know this thing in detail and the board and who governs it and protocol detail, software, source code, everything you can obtain from torproject.org. So you visit www.torproject.org and you can immediately download the Tor bundle within project, available for all operating systems, Windows, Mac, and the Linux. So, and then access to this network. Most popular part of this Tor project is Tor browser bundle. This Tor browser bundle, when you download, you may get modified or pre-configured Firefox browser, where you can use that browser to access the dark web or hidden part of the web. Plus, you can use this browser to browse clear web without revealing your identity. So especially you are OSINT people or intelligent guy, military intelligent people, or bad guys or some activist, where you don't want to reveal your trace while you do some actions. So the best solution is to use Tor browser. So then you may not let any trace in your action. Right. Let's now discuss about how this Tor works and their kind of theory behind it. So in the abstract concept, what usually Alice wants to do is talk to Dave without leaving the trace. So if Alice uses a traditional browser or traditional network connection to do that, so the trace about Alice can be recorded by Dave. So in the tour, the simply what they do is introduce set of intermediate proxies. Default it is three, but if user wants, they can extend that. Usually in the tour browser, automatically add three relays in the communication. So for example, if Alice want to take to Bob, Alice may not directly connect to Bob. Instead, Alice talk to the proxy one, proxy one talk to the proxy two talk to the proxy three, and proxy three talk to the Bob on behalf of unknown person. The last proxy, proxy three, will see the clear text packet, unencrypted packet. So there, this last proxy notes, he want to retrieve some page from this website for the Bob. So he is aware about the destination, but he didn't know about the original source. He only knows about that request comes from this proxy. And the content in between encrypted. So whatever the request comes as encrypted to the last hop, and he can only decrypt that. So he has no idea about anyone else rather than this. So when he forward this response to this after encrypting with the same key, this guy knows about this comes from this proxy. And he just forwarded it to this. And after that received to this proxy, he knows about the source. So that means if Alice source, the first entry point of this network or the Tor network will see the source, last exit point of this network, see the destination. So we will discuss that in detail. So by doing this automatically, we achieve the anonymity. So content is encrypted with multiple keys. So where we discuss how this happens in a minute. Let's say a user wants to access some other server or other website host by chain. So this browser here automatically chain the routes, and he, Alice access chains completely with new routes. So that is original design. Later on, some people has showed that there was a security issue by changing those each proxies for each connection. So after that, at the present version of Tor, is not changing those for every connection. Instead, they try to keep entry proxy as fixed for a long period. So that is kind of most trusted and most available or most long running proxies in the world. They elevated as the entry proxies, or kind of they have called guards, guard nodes. So when the end users first has to connect one of these guard nodes, after that, this guard nodes keeps without changing for a kind of long period. So what they change is the rest of the two other proxies, middle and the exit proxies, which each connections or which each set of sessions. Right. Let's see in detail how it works. how practically or how theoretically it works. Right. Let's see how practically it works. So we have the tour clients, that is the end users who are using a specific browsers which support this protocol. So in this network, some volunteers are running what they call it as directory servers. So those directory servers contain the detail about the relays, plus the detail about anonymous services, which is we will discuss in the later part of this lecture. So in the Tor clients, first time boots up or the starts, they connect to one of the directory servers. So the list of the directory servers are available to these Tor clients. They know about the IP address of directory servers. So this client first connect to one of such directory servers running all over the world. I remember the count now. When I check at the last time, it was around 600 to 1,000 directory servers running around the world. And that's consist of roughly around 6,000 relays in the world right now. So I think this relays voluntarily running by different organizations over 6,000. You can get all the details, precise details from the Tor project. So I will tell you where to obtain those. Yeah, you may get the information about the relays, directory servers. So they are public information. So if you are interested on some statistical or intelligence gathering purposes, obviously you can access those direct servers and find it out the places where people running those relays. And do the study about what's going on with those relays as well. Because the information about those relays are publicly available in the Tor directory servers. So this information is public. Everybody knows about it. Since they are decentralized and distributed, they're actually distributed, decentralized, distributed all over the world. Single entity in the world cannot control this network or cannot shut down this network. Right. So then what the Tor client do, they connect to this directory servers, one of these, and retrieve active or online Tor clients at the moment, or Tor routers, online Tor routers at the moment, or those proxy servers at the moment. So from those lists, the client pick guard node and two other nodes by default. So it's up to the client to pick them. So to take the decision, they consider the bandwidth, loads at the moment and so on. This is not randomly picked. It's not random pick. So, but it varies from one client to the other and one instance to the other instance of running. But as I mentioned, present situation, they have kind of keep the guard node kind of fixed for a long period, like 2 to 3 months, I guess. Right. So then what's happened? This client then talk to the guard node, first node, and do TPL monkey exchange over TLS and establish a session key, session symmetric key to encrypt the Tor payload or the packet. And then through that channel, Tor client pass the IP or the to IP of the next route they intend to Tor, next Tor relay they intend to Tor. So through a message called closed circuit extend message. So this, when that received to this guard node, this node will forward it to the intermediate node. So then, Tor client execute derailment K exchange session between the middle node through the guard node. And establish the key with the middle node. So this key only knows between these two persons. This key knows only between these two. Then the client forward the circuit extend message to this node and inform about his next route. So then, via these two nodes, the Tor client establishes a key with the last node. Usually we call it as exit node. So in general speaking, Tor client gather three independent keys to Tor to three nodes. While the initial phase, so that is called as circuit establishment phase. So with that, Tor client exit what we call it as Tor circuit. So after he set it up the circuit, he sends his data. Usually it's a GET request. He send Tor client say, GET request of his source website, sorry, destination website, GET request to the destination website. That first encrypted to the exit node, then it encrypted to the middle node, and then finally it encrypted to the guard node, and forward that to the guard node. Then in the guard node, then in the guard node, decrypt. When it gives the guard node decrypt outer layer of the packet using his key and forward the middle to the middle node. Then middle node decrypts outer content of this packet and forward to the exit node. Exit node decrypt final layer, inner layer, and he see the clear text request. Exit node see the clear text request after decrypting it. So he passed that clear text request to the intended web server and get the response. That response encrypted to the middle, encrypted back to the guard and encrypted to the client. So then client get the response. So where he has the keys to decrypt and get access the response. So as you see, all the requests encrypted three times by default, and each route will decrypt, each Tor route or called OR routers will decrypt onion routers. In short name is OR routers, onion routers, and will decrypt their paths and forward them. So that's how they establish and make sure your anonymity in communication. So the path they establish is called as Tor circuit. At the middle, it has the message. This is HTTP GET or POST request, and first encrypted to the exit router, router C, then encrypted to the middle router, router B, and then finally encrypted to the first router, it is router A, or the, what we call it as guard node. So So through this triple layer encrypted circuit, the web browser and the server communicates as usual. So obviously it adds the overhead to the software as well as the network, but it provides very good privacy to the servers. And through that sort of circuits, and the technology call it as anonymous, or what we call hidden services, most of the people are running what we call it as darknet. Right. Let me show you practically how it works, and then we can move on to discuss about the dark web. So how do you access the dark web? You should access the dark web through Onion browsers, that is Tor browser. This is what Tor browser look like. You can download this Tor browser from Tor project. In the Tor project, you can download the Tor browsers bundle for your system. So it has the browser bundle for all operating system plus your phone, mobile phones as well, to anonymous access. So if you only surface the web, so you can use this Tor browser bundle and start this Tor browser. It's a Firefox browser. This Tor browser, it's actually a Firefox browser which modifies to support this Tor. Mozilla Firefox modified to support this Tor protocol. If you only need to anonymously access the web or the dark web, you can use this Tor browser. Obviously, you can use any other browser to access that by setting up what we call it as local Tor proxy. I'll show that in a separate demo. So here I just demonstrate how this Tor browser works. Let me visit some website, maybe Google with Tor. So you see what's happened. So you got some message. Google seems to be not like that. So if you want to do search on the Tor browser, search for Tor project. So what they use is different search engines. Maybe I discuss that search engines in some other videos. So that call it as DuckDuck search. DuckDuckGo. DuckDuckGo is a default search engine where security professionals use because Google keep the trace. When you do search on the Google, Google knows what we search. And over the time, Google personalize the search result to us plus to the country and like that. So that sometimes not gives us the perfect results, which the point of security professionals, plus it traced into our searches. So when you use to Google over this Tor network or using Tor browser, if you want to use in Google, Google not let you to do so because Google get conflicting information about our searches. So that kind of disturbs Google personalizations, and that disturbs Google intended, intention of Google to record our search histories so they don't let us use this. So if you do search something over the Tor browser, or if you want to search over the darknet, darknet actually is the not searchable content. However, you can do some search to some extent over the darknet. So where you have to use DuckDuck search. And there are some other search engines available to do darknet search. I discuss that in a minute. Okay, using DuckDuck search, you can search in Tor. So let's open Chrome and then visit that DuckDuckGo search engine. So you can visit that as well. Using a regular browser, so you can use that. Okay, when you click that connection button here, it tells about this TLS session in the regular browser. In the Tor browser, when you check that button, it tells about the connection, plus it tells about the Tor circuit. So you see, this Tor browser connected to Onion Relay in Sweden. IP address of this relay is given. It works as the guard node to me. And then it connected to an intermediate Onion Relay in German, IP address of this. And then it connected to an Onion Relay in Sweden. The IP address of that is this, Sysystelens. And then it goes to this particular destination website. So the destination website, firewalls, traffic, analysis tools, plus all these, the recording data gathering points, will see some Sysystelen IP talk to DuckDuckGo. That's it. So in the local, my country, traffic analysis systems, ISPs, and everybody see, I talk to some server in Sweden. So these local people, it's like I'm talk to some web server in Sweden, and the DuckDuckGo or the destination is to see something like I am talk to, some Sysystelen person talk to the destination. So that's how it's anonymize this connection. For example, in this, when I, let's say, I go to Google here, see my IP, I type what is my IP, Google will tell about my IP. So that is the IP of our local ISP, internet service provider, public IP of the internet service provider. So the destination or the Google see this is as my source. But when you use the Tor project, you can see which IP is seen by the destination by typing check. Project.org. So it tells about whether I am configuring Tor properly, plus it tells about my destination IP. So I think it should match here. So it's actually changed. So here in this circuit, it tells about I am using 51.63.243, but it shows a different IP. When I check that, this is, it shows 107.147 at the end. As my destination, because even I established this Tor circuit here, as you see, it should, I expect it shows 51, 158, 65, 243 as my destination. So that is the IP when I connected to the Tor project. But this when I type check, is perhaps establish some different circuits to the last node. They change, as you see, randomly they change. So in they use a different exit node to talk to this check Tor project URL. So anyway, you see it is not the not my local IP. So it's a different IP in some other country where this exit Tor relay runs to establish this connection. So because of that, so if someone accesses the surface web through the Tor browser, so you may not reveal your anonymity. Plus, you can bypass any restriction enforced by the local ISPs to search this internet content. So for example, even Sri Lankan government banned Facebook for some particular period, but Facebook could access via Tor. Plus Facebook running hidden Tor Facebook or hidden Facebook website. So there, if some organization banned it, so we can even go to Facebook hidden page or a surface web instance or hidden instance via the Tor browser, because your local ISP may not see where you are going for. So for example, so I think in Sri Lanka, there are some news websites banned, like Lanka News. So that can directly access to the Tor. And like, I think even TamilNet, you cannot access. Through local ISPs is standard, but when you ask to go to those websites, you can get those and get the news items. If you are OSINT specialist, or if you are a law enforcement authorities, you should be able to visit those sites to gather the information. So you see the circuit here, out from exit is Sweden. Here, when I visit that, exit is German, Canada and German. Middle node is in Canada. So here, exit in Switzerland, middle node in Germany. But my entry node fix. So that's how the Tor protocol works on the point of client side. Right. Now move to the other side, interesting side, most interesting sides. That is the dark web, hidden websites. Dark web holds the internet, World Wide Web consists via these Tor networks. So such networks, we call it as overlay networks.